Hey! Welcome to Dollar Views. I'm Brian Gillis.
And I'm Stephen Motmanex.
We're just a couple of Long Beach State film grads with a lifelong passion for cinema trying to put our money where our mouths are.
And we decided to make our BAs mean something by offering our spoiler-free take on the latest film releases.
Plus, any other media we've ingested over the past week.
Whether that's the latest buzzworthy show,
an album that's been on constant rotation,
that indie darling no one can shut up about,
a cute romantic comedy,
or the latest Michael Bay masterpiece.
We go over it all. $1. At a time.
Well,
it's gonna be okay.
You're right, Clarence. I want you to meet Keanu.
No. Oh my God, that's the cutest guy I've ever seen in my life.
Why's your door open?
Keanu.
Keanu!
I'm sorry.
Oh, what's up, bro?
I'm here because my place got broken into. Has anyone shady come by here?
I mean, the 17th Street blips.
The 17th Street blips. Okay, where are they?
17th Street.
Let's just go check it out. What's the worst that can happen?
One beer, please.
I'll take a white wine spritzer.
Clarence.
What?
You can't talk like that.
Here. Then we really are in trouble because you sound like John Ritter all the time.
Well, I beg to differ, nigga.
Went straight to the N-word.
You niggas in the right place?
The right place, nigga.
Oh.
So the cat's out of the bag, folks. If you listen to our Death Cinema this week, it's kind of indebted to this film. Key and Peele's first theatrical release. Keanu. Where do we start, really? I don't know.
I had a good time. That's a good spot.
I had a good time, too. I was really worried. I purposely didn't want to see the trailer, so I showed up technically late, and because the way this movie starts, I thought I missed a lot. Like, I was in the wrong screening, so I missed nothing. I probably missed like 10 seconds or something, but just the way that that cold open happens before the title sequence, I was like, what the fuck is going on? I was checking my watch in the theater. I took out my ticket to make sure I was in the right auditorium. I was really worried, but from the get-go, this starts with a very obvious like Matrix reference,
and they carry it on as a joke throughout, talking about the flips running up the walls and all that. But goddamn, that cat can run.
That cat's awesome. It's it's seven cats, apparently. They're all shelter cats that they adopted for the film. I really hope that they went to homes after the production and not just like killed off or sold on eBay or something.
Bet. I was curious though, like how many, like if any at all, if there's any CG cats in there. I'm guessing there's probably a little bit, because how do you get a cat to move exactly the way that you would want it to?
Through training. I mean, there's CG on the cat in a couple of moments, but I mean, it looked like it was mostly stylized practical.
Moments though where it seems like it could have been. I don't know, it could just be the high speed that's capturing all those little contortions in the movement that just stick out. But I mean, yeah, you know, either way, it was interesting to look at. I mean, I don't know. How did you... I know you have a cat.
I have two cats.
All right, so did this definitely hit you?
Somewhat. I mean, I would have liked to have seen more of the kitten, maybe, like, cutaways to what it was doing during some of the action just for comedic effect. I just felt like it didn't get as much screen time as it warranted, especially with the marketing it had, the billboards with just the cat. Like, Key and Peele weren't used to market this film. It was, here's a cat with a do-rag, and it's wearing, you know, it's wearing a chain, and its name's Keanu. And then you go, oh yeah, this is that Key and Peele guys too. Like, it's gonna be funny. It's gonna be good.
I mean, it's all you need to market it. It's just cats, and then people will naturally go ooh and ah. And you know what they did? I mean, my screening was sold out. Mm-hmm. And this was at the Alamo too. Like the whole pre-show, nothing but cat stuff.
That's cool.
I imagine for you, because you've tweeted about just laying next to your cat, and
it's been a running gag the last couple of weeks or so. Yeah, most of my tweets over the last month or so have been about my cat.
Yeah, so it's like, how much does that resonate with you? Just those little. Those little moments.
No, I loved it. And anytime Keanu or Iglesias or what was his other name? I forget. New Jack. Anytime the cat or cats, as we said, it is multiple, is on screen, I loved it. It's just like I said, there wasn't quite enough for me. I was looking for a little bit more because I'm not a Key and Peele fan. I've seen their show. I mean, it's over now. They only did the 3 seasons. I kind of know they are. You know, I've seen their YouTube videos. I've seen some of their stuff. Have you? I know you don't have cable.
I didn't watch the show, but I've mainly, like, no? I've seen stuff on YouTube. The first one I saw was the dubstep sketch, which that one's really funny, I think, and on point, too.
Well, there's some really great sketches that they have. The Liam Neeson stuff. There's like one where they're valets.
Like me and my friends still quote that one, and I mean they make a reference with that joke here, and it's pretty funny.
Or like the one about the guy that's too much of a gangster to sit down. Like he's gonna lean against the chair. Like there's some or slap ass. There's some really good ones. I don't watch Comedy Central enough. Like Broad City, yeah, I watch that. But this is kind of like you already referenced that the Liam Neeson thing is in this. This is kind of, it seemed like from just the little that I've seen of their show, like a greatest hits on the big screen.
Oh, there's definitely fan service in there. I mean, at least with the Liam Neeson's joke. You know, I never watched a full episode of the show. And that's kind of just my thing with sketch comedy. It's, you know, it's like I love SNL, but right now, like, I wouldn't watch a full episode probably because I'd like probably 1 or 2 sketches. And how often is it that you see a great one? Probably once every few months. That ends up on YouTube anyway.
But usually when I watch SNL, when I actually decide to, for whatever host or guest, there's usually probably one every other episode. There's something really, really great, but it is like you said, you can just watch it on YouTube. YouTube kind of killed the sketch show.
Yeah.
I still don't know what I think about this movie. I definitely enjoyed it. I liked it. Like, it's a great action comedy, but it's not necessarily a special just when you take it as a comedy or an action flick. It's not good in those regards, but as a whole, it's pretty good.
It is a good time in the theater. I mean, this is, it's really one joke.
Which is, you know, when you're writing, when the screenwriting, like, rules is, how do you get someone to care for a character? You know, you put a cat in a tree, and then the guy saves the cat. And this film is, like, a joke on that. It's like a meta joke that very few people are going to get. Like, that's what I tweeted out on $4 Reviews. By the way, go follow us or like us on Facebook. And it is what it is, and I kind of enjoy that. I'm sure it's going to do well this weekend, despite being
that's already doing well.
A somewhat hard R. I wouldn't really say it's that hard.
I was at a sold-out screening at 3 in the afternoon, so it's...
Well, see, I went to a show at 3 p.m. Well, I went to the Cinemark again, and their auditoriums, despite being big, only have so many seats, so I'm not sure if it was sold out. But it seemed like it was at capacity.
I mean, I think it'll open around, like, at least 20 mil. Like, it should do fine this weekend, especially given the budget that it is. It's going to do well, and it's going to have legs.
I think it's going to do better. I think it's going to be closer to 30. I think they have enough of a built-in audience, plus the cat stuff, plus the people, the supporting actors, Nia Long, Method Man, Anna Faris, like, Will Forte.
It's going to be, like, 10, 15. Friday night, it had $3.5 million.
Really?
And that's just a guesstimate, yeah.
I know they did well Thursday. I know Thursday night they made something like 400,000, which is really good for an R. That's not a superhero film. Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'm not in the box office game. We don't even talk about it on the show, really. I love Will Forte. I think he's the best thing about this film besides the cat.
I never knew that was him.
What?
I didn't find that out like until probably like 20 minutes ago as I was doing research on my phone for this movie. I did not know that was him.
Like, he's got
the beard. I've
seen that
trailer so many times, and I did not know that was him.
Like, he's still got the beard from The Last Man on Earth on this film.
Well, which you watch, I don't.
Well, a lot of people watch it. It's a great show. Like, I don't care what film he's in. I don't care how stupid it is. There's just something about him, or that's The Ridiculous Six, or fucking Nebraska, or... what's some other shit he's in? He has a lot of bit parts and stuff. MacGruber, I just love him for some reason, and I hated him on SNL. I didn't watch SNL, really. I still don't. But he's probably the biggest crossover success in my eyes, because it's not like the charisma of Adam Sandler. That's not his shtick. It's just there's something really funny about him, in my opinion. I don't know what it is. He's just, because you love him, but he's, like, also hilarious. Even as a white drug dealer who knows everything about rap, in his own words.
Well, he wasn't the
highlight. Come on, homies, I know everything about rap. Don't kill me.
The highlight for me is And I don't want to spoil it, or I don't know. Is it a spoiler to say that Anna Faris is in this movie? Because she's already credited. Kinda,
I already said she is.
It's that, and then the God damn it, now I'm blanking out. Yeah, the George Michael stuff.
Yeah,
like,
I mean
that's the best stuff in this movie. To the extent that joke goes, and it's a running joke, but it's constantly doing something new with it.
It's weird because, like I said, I haven't seen their show much, but I feel like that's a joke that they've used on the show before. Like, not to this extent, and I doubt there's a George Michael episode where every punchline is about him. But there's still a lot of missed opportunities here, just in terms of him. Like, they never bring up, you know, him fucking dudes in cars or in, you know, like public bathrooms or anything, or I don't know, like Eli Stone on ABC. George Michael was a running gag on that also. Like, they, because people would just randomly break out in a song, but they like put it behind the excuse of Johnny Lee Miller having a brain aneurysm, and so he would basically have these musical fantasies related to George Michael, and he even had a role in the show. And then stuff like, you know, Arrested Development, there's a character named George Michael. It is a fairly easy joke that is used fairly frequently. But yeah, I agree. It is very good here.
Yeah, despite it's not how something much I've seen. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't watch Arrested Development, even though, yeah, I do know that that's a character's name. And I mean, yeah, just the way that the joke is used. Like, it's funny when they use it in the van. It's funny when they use it in that tripping sequence. There's several
tripping sequence
ways that it's used.
They, talking about a tripping sequence, there is an hallucination sequence here. It's not that important, but I have to say this. I already did it personally, both on Facebook and Twitter, for my own accounts, not dollar views. But Slash Film, they're a bunch of assholes. They weren't doing their job because no one else fucking did it. If someone
Everyone reported that.
Who?
It was on AnyCool. It was through my Twitter stream. It wasn't just Slash Film.
They're the
there
only
were
person
links to
that
other websites reporting that.
Only people that I follow that did that. That okay, I personally follow.
Only people that you follow.
That's what I'm saying. Like, who? Who are these accounts? Who else are assholes on the internet?
Do I really need... it was the internet, okay? Do I really have to go this far back and look?
Yeah.
Okay, well, it's not... There's no way it'll be able to scroll back like 5 days ago.
Because it's not someone I follow.
I only
follow the important people, but I didn't. I would have been oblivious.
It was reported in, what was it, LA Weekly? First off, this is the director that reported this stuff. This is the studio that put this information out.
There's an LA,
the movie came
there's
out.
A Los Angeles Times article about the film. I'm sure the headline to it was, director of Key and Peele makes his big movie splash. Here's his interview. And there was a quote, not, by the way, guys, yes, that was bleep. It's not the most important thing in the movie. It really means nothing. But I could have had a great experience with a holy shit moment. Instead, I went, hey, guess what? I know exactly what that this was going to happen, exactly where it happened.
Uprox did it. Entertainment Weekly did it. You just type in Keanu Reeves. IGN had it.
I don't follow. Well, that's the thing. I don't follow. I don't follow them because I only.
Okay, but these are big sites, and everyone was reporting it. That's what I'm saying.
That's horrible.
I mean, it's news. No. It sucks that the information.
If
was
you
out there,
watch
but it
a movie
news.
And there's,
it was reported as news, and it was put out there. But and you know what? They okayed it. They wanted that information out there. It's not like there was an ethical responsibility to wait until that time. It's not like Warner Brothers said, hey, wait to put this out. No, they just gave it to them. And of course, everyone was going to report it. So it just went out like that.
That's horrible.
Yeah. And I mean, plus, you know what? In the context that it's described in, I can see how they wouldn't really care. Because once I saw it, I was just kind of like, oh, okay. And you know, we're talking about it now. We don't have any hesitations of revealing it. So, I mean, really, is it that big a deal?
Yeah, it ruined...
why are we talking about it?
I could have got a really good laugh. It was a good joke. And because I already knew the punchline, there was no joke.
you already said on past shows that, hey, Keanu Reeves better make an appearance, otherwise you're going to be unhappy. So.
Exactly. And so if I didn't know going in and I was surprised, I would have got more of my money's worth. But when you ruin a joke, and maybe it wasn't Slash Film's fault, as you said, it was the internet's fault.
It was everybody. But I think when, you're just blaming the one person that you follow that ends up putting this stuff out
there. I'm blaming the headline. I
do think it could have been handled differently, but then again, everybody did this, and it's like, you know what, me personally, I would have handled it differently.
But you see, there's a big
but
the people that I follow for 2 cents reporting are the major players, plus Slash Film. It's, you know, Variety and THR and fucking Deadline Hollywood and you know, some inside players, you know, Benardine from Fat Man on Batman, Kevin Smith, you know, like people in the industry, plus Slash Film. And so when the only person in my newsfeed, or the only people, the in their own words, the only independent movie blog left on the planet, makes that headline, when their audience, when their reader base is supposed to be people that are very passionate about films, that is their the reason they exist, right? When they step over the boundary and in your own tweet said, there could have been a way to say this, instead of going, you're never going to guess who makes a cameo in this film, or guess what, that cute cat in that Key and Peele movie, he has a voice. Like, if you do something that was clickbait, if you made me want to find out, sure, I don't fucking use the punchline as a tweet. There was no way of me avoiding it. There's no way of multiple people. I interacted with them on Facebook and Twitter.
I think that's fair. You look at the comments. You look at the comments of that article. Other people lost their shit as well. I mean, I'm not saying you're wrong. I just don't think it's that bad. Like,
pretty bad.
Everybody else did it. The information was put out there.
It's not so and so kills so and so. You know, it's not blah 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 is a sled. This is a no name director with two guys that have like never starred in a movie. With the low budget, it's supposed to be a shock. It's supposed to be a good time.
Well, and they gave it away, so...
Yeah, they did give it away. Everyone gave it away, apparently. And my problem wasn't necessary, or my problem isn't, rather, because it's an ongoing thing, that they did it. It was that both their editor-in-chief, Peter Scaretta, and the author, Jacob S. Hall, both said to many people, not just me, or... directly to me anyway, that it wasn't a spoiler. Like, how is it not a spoiler? You ruined a joke. Or maybe you didn't ruin it, but you told your reader base about the joke. You ruined it for the people that might have not known. If I did not follow them, I would have not known. And now I don't want to follow them anymore because they've consistently gotten shittier about the kind of content that they put out there. And now... I got no interest in them since all they fucking do is basically retweet what the majors do anyway.
This is still a review of Keanu, right?
Not anymore, no. Still fucking witch hunt.
Nah, I mean, hey, you know, I think, yeah, the article, the headline could have been handled differently. I do think that, like, the article's fine, but it's just they could have posted something instead of like, hey, here's how that cameo that's in Keanu came to be.
Exactly.
You know, put like
make it clickbait.
Like
don't,
that. Yeah.
Much in the same way that they ruin the punchline, they ruin the story before even hinting at it.
Yeah, no. So I mean, it's not a well put together headline. But then again, everyone else did it, so it's not like I can blame one site.
I can't feel bitter about it.
It was tough to escape because I have Twitter and everyone posted the same.
No, that's what I'm saying though. On the other sites you listed, IGN and Entertainment Weekly, they're not movie sites. They cover lots of stuff. IGN started because of video games. They're more known for comic book coverage than they are for movies. Like, yes, they cover Star Wars big time. They have their superhero section, whatever the fuck it's called. They have these other things, kind of like 2 cents, where it's a roundup of all the other news related to that. You know, they have that page 2 stuff. But there's a lot of people that follow him, just like me, for the movie stuff and only for the movie stuff. And to go that low. To alienate me and others when their demographic is supposed to be people that care about movies, it's very upsetting to me. And the fact that they try to spin it as not a problem, that they still don't think that they should apologize.
I don't. I got the same exact answer here. Is that I have a hard time blaming this one site when everyone else was doing the same fucking thing. So
I don't know. Like I said, I really like the supporting cast in this movie. I think it was whoever put the pieces together did a really good job. It's not the best script ever written. It's not the funniest thing ever made. I mean, Deadpool's still a better comedy that came out this year. But as you said earlier, it is a very good, you know, it's a feel-good comedy. It's an audience pleaser. There's kind of quotable moments here. But it's really cat porn. If you enjoy the Animal Planet or liking stupid cat videos, you're going to at least get a smile that you can't, like, get off your face. There's some really great punchlines involving the cat, especially with some photos that are used in the credits. I think the worst thing about this movie is probably the post-credit sequence and that whole third act, to be honest.
There's post-credit?
Yeah. I'll say it off air. But they basically really, really, really set up a sequel. And they tried to make it happen.
It's pretty ballsy, yeah.
Yeah, like really hard. And I'm not a fan of that. I don't think that this joke would be funny a second time. Like,
it was
not that great the first time around.
I mean, that's the thing. It is a one joke movie, but it is able to maintain the momentum. So it doesn't feel like the joke's being drilled in my head the whole time. And they keep it going. So, I mean, yeah, you know, it is a good time. It's a movie that if you find it on Netflix, or in this case, you're going to find it on HBO Go or HBO Now, and you just want to watch something and laugh, then yeah, it'll be that. It'll be that movie that's on Comedy Central that you watch when you're bored.
Mm-hmm.
Although it's one of the better ones.
Yeah. I think we agree that we're not going to buy this one for a dollar, but there are definitely worse things to see. I enjoyed this more than I enjoyed The Jungle Book, for instance, even though that, you know, is a visual feast.
I would recommend seeing this one with a crowd, honestly, because it is a good time. It's a fun movie to check out. Yeah, it's not going to change your life, but yeah. it's a good laugh with, and it's good to have the audience experience with that.
Put it this way, Civil War is out next weekend. I'm going to go see it. I can already pretty much guarantee that it'll be a better buy than this is. And that's not saying it's bad. Like I said, this is a fun movie. It's a good time.
It's going to be a very, very different movie for one.
I think it'll be funnier than this is, to be honest.
Well, I don't know.
I'm expecting zingers from Spider-Man. I'm like, when he's on screen, if I'm not applauding at some point because he was so funny that I lost it, I'm going to be dissatisfied.
I'm sure it'll be fine. Everyone's lost their shit already.
Yeah,
so,
I haven't read any of those reviews.
It's not like it's got the 50-50 reaction that Batman v Superman had. It seems pretty unanimous here that people are going to be happy at the very least.
Well, were you happy about anything else this week? You watch anything else?
I saw some weird shit this week. I guess, you know, I'll go through. I know one of them you saw for sure, or have seen. But yeah, one that I saw, it's a recent movie that played at Fantastic Fest last year called The Space Program. It's weird. It's kind of like one of those movies that in Be Kind Rewind that are sweeted, you know, that are shot with a video camera, except
it's real.
Yeah, what this is that it's a fake space program, like a do-it-yourself space mission to Mars where, I mean, yeah, just, and it makes a big deal that, oh, we're sending these two women to Mars in the first time in human history, and also, like, there's a live audience that's there in the corner that's watching it. It's really weird, and it's not...
Sounds horrible.
Really, it's not really my cup of tea, but it is interesting, as I'll say at the very least. I think it'll probably, once it hits VOD, it'll probably be on like Netflix or on Amazon. It is an interesting watch, and there's some really weird humor. Like there's definitely moments that I laughed, but I was like so close to actually dismissing it as hipster trash, because this thing opens with a really, really long, or it felt very long, like, just tutorial on the different types of wood. And, like, that just centers around, like, how they built all this stuff. So I guess, I don't know what reality this is set in that's trying to convey, but it was interesting. It seems like a lot of people dug it. I mean, it's got 90% on Rotten Tomatoes, so it's something that people seem to like. But one of the weird things that I really... really want to talk about, and then I'm glad I discovered, is this movie from the 80s called Surf 2. Have you ever heard of this?
No.
All right. Well, the movie is called Surf 2, the end of a trilogy.
There is no Surf 1, I'm guessing.
That's part of the joke, is that this is basically a spoof movie from the 80s. And, you know, in the 80s, we had Airplane, then we had Airplane 2. You know, there was the Police Academy movies and their sequels. There was the Naked Gun series and their sequels.
Are you just naming just Zucker movies?
That's pretty much, they were the ones, right? So,
yeah.
Did the Zuckers do Police Academy?
Yeah. The first one, anyone, the Police Squad.
I have not seen a single Police Academy movie. So.
They also did, they did Hot Shots. All of them. The scary movie sequels.
Well, this is weird because it's kind of a spoof of a spoof movie, but that's not even the insane part. Okay, I mean, this movie, what this is about is basically a very, very nerdy mad scientist played by Eddie Deason who hates surfers. So what he does is he invents this soda this cola that he calls it Buzz
surfers.
Cola. And what it does is that when they drink it, they all turn into punk zombies.
That sounds good. I'd watch that.
Yeah, no, it's crazy. Like, there's an Eric Stoltz is in this. I mean, there's just so many messed up. There's always a gag, like, every 30 seconds in this, and just a ton of weird, weird stuff going on. Like, there's a really cool sort of split screen sequence. There's something I got a good laugh out of is that the police chief is named Chief Boyardee. And everyone calls him Chef throughout. That's one of the many jokes on this. But here's the thing, is that this movie was never released on DVD. I think the only way that you can find it, if you don't find a 35mm screening, it's VHS. And I guess according to Wikipedia, it's also got a cult through YouTube. So a copy of the movie might be up on there. But you know what? I saw a really good print of this, and apparently what they're gonna do is that AGFA, the American Film Genre Association, that they host these screenings, and that's where most of these prints come from. They have a film scanner where they're able to preserve some of these movies at 2K, and I guess this is going to be one of them, so you could see a Blu-ray release or a DVD release of this soon, or stream it on Amazon or somewhere, I don't know. But yeah, it's this is not on any digital intermediate whatsoever, so we'll see. I mean, this movie is crazy. You really have to see this. It's not like something that's bad in the sense of you can easily just dismiss it as some crap from, of its time. This was so much fun. It's so fucking weird, but I think, it's a shame that this is not easily accessible out there for more people. But yeah, there are clips on YouTube, and you know, you just got to see this. Hopefully you will be able to soon. But the third thing that I saw that's really, really fucking weird, but is really good, I think, legitimately good, I saw Baz Luhrmann's Romeo plus Juliet for the first time.
Great, isn't it?
In the same sense, there's a lot of similarities to Great Gatsby, just as far as the type of story.
It's the same kind of movie.
Yeah, exactly the same kind of movie. And I loved Great Gatsby.
Have you seen any else he's done?
I saw Australia. That was the first one I saw. I have not seen Moulin Rouge. I mean,
same kind of movie. His whole shtick is taking old stories.
It's basically more is more.
Yeah, right? Well, it's that, but then it's also taking these olden time stories or historic plot lines, Romeo and Juliet or Moulin Rouge or fucking Great Gatsby, and just bringing them to the present in a really cool way. The only exception here is Strictly Ballroom, his first movie, which is just a dance movie, but it's really fun. It has the same kind of comedic timing. But for instance, in Moulin Rouge, for some fucking reason, they start singing Nirvana. I think it was the first movie that did that stupid shit. They do a tango to Roxanne by the Police, but it's sung in such a way that you kind of don't know what song it is until it happens. And that happens all over the place now. Look at The Social Network having Nirvana sung by a choir and stuff like that. It's a pretty commonplace thing.
I was Radiohead, I think.
Oh, it was Radiohead, my mistake. Yeah. It was Creep, yeah. But the Nirvana, something happens with Nirvana, currently for Uncharted 4 trailer that's on TV. It is pretty, it's all over the place now, but I'm pretty sure he kind of bucked that trend, especially with this movie. And, the just how ballsy this movie was
a pretty big hit.
Yeah, no, huge hit. Like it was Leo's first real hit. Like this was like 2 years before Titanic. It was like 1 or 2 years after What's Eating Gilbert Grape. Like it was his real first starring role that made him someone like a heartthrob.
No, I forgot that Brandy Svenning was in this movie too. But I mean, in this movie, it ended up being like a huge hit, right?
Yeah, John Leguizamo. Like, I think it made like 220 international or something like that.
I mean, yeah, that's insane. I'm looking it up right now. Actually, the budget was right under $15 million,
and it made a lot. And it still makes a lot. It's a huge home media seller. Like
the screening was packed. I was in a full sold out screening, and this was at normal theater ticket pricing. It wasn't discounted or anything for classic screening, but it was for like it was $10.50 just to get in, and it was packed.
Like Baz Luhrmann has a pretty good like fan base, you know, but it's kind of split just between Moulin Rouge and Romeo and Juliet. Like Australia, Great Gatsby, they're outside of that. Strictly Ballroom is outside of that. But between just those two films, there's so many people that love it and probably don't even know his name. I've had conversations with several women about his works, and I'm like, I'm not really a fan. And then I finally saw Strictly Ballroom. Like, I totally get this guy. This is amazing. Like, I want to live in this movie. It sounds like you like this. I would check that one out.
Yeah.
I think it was on Netflix. It might come back to Netflix. The Strictly Ballroom.
I don't know. We'll see. I mean, I'd say Baz Luhrmann. I don't want to say, like, I love his movies, you know, because at the very least, I think what I remember of Australia is, like, I liked it. Great Gatsby, I really enjoyed, Like, I own that movie, you know. I really love how insane it is. You know, I love the 3D of that movie. It really is kind of crazy. And this is the same thing, although Great Gatsby, that's one I own because I like that story more, and I just like that text, and
I like his weird, like, fast, like, sped up moments to kind of make things go faster. Pace at which they move, how fast people talk.
It's just funny, like, yeah, I mean, this holds up very well stylistically, but it's very, very experimental for the time. And, like, I mean, it's, you know, especially now seeing this, I have a much, much better sense of what his style is. And, I mean, yes, you know, like, I'm kind of joking, which is, like, yeah, there's no subtlety. More is more, just jam everything that you can in the frame, but everything is just so detailed, and, like, you know, you spend so much time trying to get it to be a very specific way that, you know, it's very experimental, but it ends up working. That was something that I loved about the Great Gatsby, is that even though it kind of ended up just making, like, all the pros of F. Scott Fitzgerald, it made it, like, you know, a literal, like, just a visual representation of it. It worked out much better for that movie. I think that's the best adaptation of that story that there is out there.
Well, there's only two other ones.
I mean, yeah, no, I mean, and the one from the 70s is so fucking bad.
I haven't seen it. Horrible. I mean, I didn't see.
There's a silent film version.
But I didn't even see that film as an adaptation of The Great Gatsby because it was marketed as just Gatsby, and so that's how I took it as. I didn't try to compare the two.
Yeah, and I will say this, though, also. I mean, it's also a Leo movie, and, yeah, Great Gatsby has the better performance, just the better character in general. But then again, that's because Leo is a more seasoned actor at that point.
I don't think that's what it is.
Romeo and Juliet is just...
When you're playing a star-crossed 15-year-old, 14-year-old, whatever he is...
Yeah, no, it's the role that basically... That's what it asks for.
Romeo and Juliet isn't acclaimed... I'm not saying the movie, just, you know, the play in general, the script... It's not acclaimed for how great it is. It's just, it's really the first real example. Like, it created the start, like, you know, from dueling families, and yet they love each other anyway. Like, it invented that archetype, or at least as far as we can tell in history. And so that's why it's important. And that is this is the end-all, be-all adaptation, because it literally uses the same words. The dialogue is not changed. And it became a trend. I mean, look at as recent, it was like 2 years ago, 3 years ago, when Joss Whedon made his Much Ado About Nothing, which did the exact same thing verbatim.
Although, I mean,
Hamlet 2000, same thing.
I want to say they definitely had to retool some of the dialogue to make it modern in some way, right? I mean,
I'm pretty sure it is
there are some things that that reference key things that seem modern, but then again, you know what, they didn't refer to guns as guns, they did refer to them as swords.
Yeah, steel. Yeah, like, so they do it in a very iconic, very like kitschy, very fun way. Like when John Leguizamo draws his swords, and it does like that big zoom in on the handle, and it says like steel, and you're like, oh, I get it, that's funny. But it, as far as I can remember, it is not a changed script. It just has the visual flourishes. It makes a movie around a story that everyone already knows. And so they're able to attract the theater geeks and the Shakespeare nerds and, you know, fans of Leonardo DiCaprio, plus anyone that just wanted to see something with new music. Like, Radiohead, I think, wrote like two songs for that movie. One of them's on OK Computer. They got, on Kid A, rather. No, yeah, OK Computer. Someone else, like, I know it had like a lot of really popular musicians or acclaimed musicians at the time to do this, not the score but the soundtrack, and that's something that still happens. Look at the Twilight movies and how big their soundtracks were, even 50 Shades of Grey. Like, if a film has a built-in audience like that, if it's gonna be a date movie or try to attract like a primarily female clientele, they do it from more than just one facet. It's not just the film, it's not just the actors, it's the t-shirts, it's the soundtrack, it's the whatever else, the tie-in novel.
I mean, just the I guess the visual flourishes of Baz Luhrmann, you know how it's funny because it does, there's so many parallels to Great Gatsby here. Just like, I mean, not just as far as story, but yeah, like as the way that the movie opens, the way that it draws you in by starting on like something small and then making it bigger.
By the way, it's a TV. Do you love Paul Rudd's role in that film?
Yes.
Or this film, rather?
Yes, yes.
It's everyone like, he's barely even fucking in it, and yet he steals every scene. You're like, this guy's a retard.
What the fuck? He's in an astronaut suit, and he just has like,
he's on newspapers and like, video
of course,
ads.
And all the women were laughing in the theater. And I mean, that's one of the moments where you can just tell, like, yeah, they've seen this before because they were anticipating that fully. But it's just so ridiculous. And I'm just, in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, wait, that's Ant-Man right there.
Or before he was Ant-Man.
That's the dude in Judd Apatow movies that is shitting on a toilet yelling at Judd Apatow's wife.
Like, at the time, it was more like, hey, that's the older brother from Clueless.
Nah, but I mean, yeah, there is a really good cast in this movie. I mean, yeah, John Leguizamo.
He's good in everything.
You know, really good. Pete Postlewaite, though, like, he, you know, who, rest in peace, by the way.
He plays
the
priest, right?
The priest, yeah. Also really good. But anyway, I wouldn't buy it over a dollar, maybe not like over Great Gatsby, but I did really, really enjoy it. I'm glad that I saw this in a theater for the first time. Yeah, it's a very, very big, very just crazy ride. Like, it, I don't think at the end of it, and I mean, this is Romeo and Juliet, we all know the story, we all know the ending. I don't think that there was really the emotional resonance in there at all for me. Like, I didn't really actually care that much for the relationship, but just this world and just the style of it, like, I was fully drawn in, and it's it really is a ride, which is the weirdest thing to call a Romeo and Juliet story. But I'm sure, as far as I know, this has always had the reputation of being very divisive, with good reason, but it's a very, very experimental adaptation, and I think it's really fun just for what this movie is doing, just to take it on those terms. I was fully on board.
Yeah, I think I've only seen it twice, maybe in passing a third. It's not something that I would buy for a dollar either, but it is something that I think is a must watch. Like, it is within its own self, like a singular experience, unless, as I said, and you've already kind of said, you've seen other works by Baz Luhrmann. But I think it makes something that's kind of inaccessible by today's standards fun and enjoyable, which is why it's an important film, and why, as I said earlier, other filmmakers have tried to tap into the same thing to adapt other Shakespearean works. You know,
this is just true authorship too. I mean, yeah. Like, you know, at this point I got a really good sense of even though I can't I don't know if Australia is a good example.
His Oscar baity. I'm from Australia. I'll get my whole cast to be from Australia. We'll make a movie about a war. Like Australia's, it was World War II, right? It's like we're gonna show you that Australia was important during that war too, and this is how, and this is patriotism, and this is made by Village Roadshow, and all this shit. I think George Miller like produced it. Like basically anyone in Hollywood that was related to Australia made that movie, and that's why I have not seen it. And I got no desire to. But that's not one of
his
movies.
It's a pretty good movie, honestly.
It's just something that he made.
It's not perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, you should check it out. Like, it's
someday,
got
maybe.
Some not so good moments, but then there was also some good stuff because it's a movie that is kind of three movies into one. It's the Western first, and then it's the romance in the middle,
and then it's
the war movie.
Yeah, like I'm sure at some point I'll be interested enough. Well, I mean, I am interested enough, but I'm sure at some point it will be on TV right when I'm looking for a movie, or it'll come to Netflix, and I'll go, yeah, fuck it, why not? But I got very little interest to watch a 3-hour. Film about Australia. Like, my grandpa lives in Australia. He's lived there my entire life, and he told me himself, do not watch this movie, it's not good. And I went, you know what, I trust your opinion, grandpa. You said the same thing about The Heat. Not watching that piece of shit, no thanks.
Well, if you want to take another really strange like war movie that's from a very, very stylized, very auteur-driven filmmaker. I mean, I guess the best thing I can liken it to is Michael Bay's Pearl Harbor.
Except that movie sucks.
And so does Australia. Kind
yeah,
of.
Like
they're,
I am.
Both
I'm not
odd beast in someone's.
Like you know this about me.
Beast in someone's filmography in that sense.
Like, you know, I'm not a Michael Bay hater, but even someone who is a big fan of his work.
Well, I wrote a very long piece. For anyone that wants to read it, but I mainly just kind of wrote that for myself, trying to justify
why you
that
don't
movie.
Hate it. Hate it.
Just trying to like justify it and criticize it at the same time.
Like,
I kind of find that a fascinating movie.
Correct me if I'm wrong, but about half of that movie is a love triangle between Ben Affleck, what's her name, and who's the other guy? Who's the third wheel?
Josh Hartnett.
Josh Hartnett is like more than half of the movie, and that kind
of—it's
of,
not a horrible idea. It's just
it like
it's,
doesn't
it's
it
not a well realized one?
It propels the action
the
too.
That's
if I remember, correctly, like shit's going down, and Ben Affleck's like, "Oh my God, Liv Tyler's on that boat. I gotta go save her."
It's Kate Beckinsale, not Liv
Whatever.
Tyler's Armageddon. But it's good that you're remembering the right one—the one that matters.
Like
and not enough Animal Crackers and Pearl Harbor also, but. Well, the problem with Pearl Harbor is just that the romance is like it's not well realized. Like the ingredients are there, but it realizes them so poorly and
like,
just kind of throws them.
Like what the fuck
also,
were they trying to do?
The characters are literally two dimensional.
Yeah,
they don't feel like actual human beings. They just feel like plot devices for a romance.
I remember like
and
Josh
when you get
Hartnett
to the actual
getting into a fight with Ben Affleck, and like they both get their ass kicked, and I just went. I'm sorry, am I supposed to care right now that they're bloodied and beat up?
No, everyone's a two-dimensional person. Like, we don't... these people don't feel like human
Isn't
beings
Isn't Cuba Gooding Jr. in that
the,
movie?
He is, yeah.
And all he does is go, woo, I shot it!
Yeah. Yeah, no, it makes a big deal. It's like, yeah, he was the first
the first black dude
to
shoot down a
plane.
Get the
Medal of Honor or something.
There's some shit,
But whatever. Hey, that movie is that movie. Romeo plus Juliet. How else can you see it? I know that there's an and within that plus sign, but come on, it's. You know, when you say Romeo plus Juliet, everyone's gonna know that this is the one that you're talking about.
Laz Berman's Romeo and Juliet. It is one of those.
Yeah,
it is not a horror film. Like there is the Shakespearean play, and then there's what he did to it, or did for it rather. Like he did make it. Better than its parts. It is not the best play. Like it's kind of asinine that two 13-year-olds would kill themselves because their families wouldn't allow them to love one another. It's like you're 13.
Yeah, well, fucking. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I don't know. I might have done the same thing when I was 13.
No, not when I was 13.
Fortunately, that never
like,
happened.
15,
but...
15, yeah. Like actually, like in full fledged, like hormones. Like I'm almost
I don't
an adult mode.
I don't want to dwell on it anymore. But you know what? I mean, this movie, I recommend you see it, and yes, there's very well the possibility that you can hate it, but you will definitely not be bored by it, and you definitely will not forget it.
I really
how can you?
Like, I really movie, think like, the only people that could hate his adaptation are people that are like crazily obsessed with Shakespeare. Like, if you're the kind of person that goes, fuck 10 sure. things I hate about you, this is a horrible adaptation of Taming the Shrew. If you're one of those people, yeah, you probably don't like the movie. But if you're a regular Joe, like, oh, I know who Shakespeare is, I've heard some of his plays, like, I've read one or two, then it's a perfect excuse to, you know, get into, you know, some of his great craftsmanship. If he's even a real person, you know, we just celebrated the 400th anniversary of the Bard. But anyone that's seen Shakespeare in Love knows another Ben Affleck movie, nonetheless.
All right, well, I don't know. Okay, one more thing here. That I don't know. I always want to talk about this movie. Whenever I get the chance. But have you seen Alien 3?
Yeah. Shit. Total shit. It's a surprise to me that David Fincher was able to get a career, and a good career at that, after a god awful, not only, you know, first film, but a sequel to one of the biggest franchises Fox had at the time, besides Star Wars. It's crazy that his career didn't tank right away.
Well, you know, the reason I ask is because I did see it, and I rewatched the, well, in this case, it was the theatrical cut, which was on 35, which I disavowed that cut. You know, I actually think, even rewatching it, I still think the theatrical cut at least is kind of good. And full disclosure, by the way, I love the movie.
You don't have to be about everything.
Well, I am actually kind of right here. At least I think I'll be justified, because have you only seen the theatrical cut, or have you seen
I saw the only version that's supposed to exist.
You've never seen the assembly cut?
No.
Okay, well, that could be a death cinema one day for a good reason, too.
No.
It's not like I'm pulling a Freddy Got Fingered. Yeah, no, it could very well be.
Like, I'm probably watching the theatrical cut of Blade Runner tonight. I have a feeling like I want to, even though
I'm
know it's
that?
Yeah, like I know it's supposed to be the shitty version of the movie, but I want to see, you know, what it's like when Harrison Ford phones it in. Like, I want it.
Honestly,
I think
it feels like a pretty good like film noir.
Exactly.
Just
that's
movie.
I want to see that.
Yes, like it's not nearly as unique, but there is an effect to it that's cool. Alien 3, it's a whole different thing, because that movie is a mess. Like, if you just, knowing how that production went down, the story of how that movie got made is really, really fascinating. Like, if you're able to track down that documentary and you're interested, I fully recommend that you do so, because it's just, I mean, how that happens in Hollywood, just like all the shit that David Fincher had to go through, and the fact that they start production without a script and all the inconsistencies, it's like, it's such a bummer, because, like, if they had done everything right, if they had planned it out right and had the time to get the script fine-tuned, we could have had an incredible movie, honestly.
Yeah, maybe.
I think. And like, I think, you know, what stands in Alien 3, like, there's just too much good stuff in there for me to fully disown it and call it bad. Like, I think the big thing here that I think fans just hate is that everyone hates the fact that Newton Hicks gets killed. And you know what?
That's
watching
the black
the theatrical
guy, right?
cut, Hicks?
Is that the black guy?
No, Hicks is Michael Biehn.
Does he die in that? I don't know. I haven't.
Do you remember Aliens at all?
I've seen it a couple times. I remember the important stuff. I remember the climax. That's the important part.
Okay, well, basically, at, like, that happy ending that you get, like, or that relief
yeah.
of an ending
yeah,
that
like
you get in Aliens.
Newt and Ripley and Michael Biehn
yeah,
fly away.
And that's like, Nope. Ripley survives and she loses everyone else. And, like, yeah, they kill a fucking 8-year-old girl and that pisses people off. And you know what? Watching the theatrical cut, yeah, it feels like a piece of exposition that they just dump out there to get the movie started. Like, it's really kind of a shit move. It really does feel
Did
like a
you
fuck you.
Did you see the Neil Blomkamp the concept drawing of Newt as an
yeah,
adult?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I know. We've talked about this, that they're disowning 3. Like,
And yeah. Resurrection, mind you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, well, I mean, Resurrection's a weird
so
movie. I don't
weird.
Hate
hey,
it, but
I got
it's
an idea.
Definitely a...
What if Ripley becomes the queen of the aliens? What if she's the leader of the Xenomorphs? Like,
hey, shit on that movie as much as you want, but you can definitely see little bits of Firefly in there. Like there are good things in all Alien movies. There are
there's definitely redeeming qualities.
Well, anyway, like okay, Alien 3, I guess the main thing that I'm trying to get across, like even though yes, this is the weaker cut, but like I still and I'm very actually curious to check out the cut that I like soon again, but there's so many things that I still feel like I think that this is the one that has Sigourney Weaver's best performance.
No, it's two.
Mainly because it asks a lot of her. I mean, this is a movie that, you know, is very jarring because after when you start out having a horror movie and then you have an action movie, it's very, very jarring to do a spiritual movie that's about hopelessness and loss and just deals with mortality and faith and... It really does go into places that are not expected, but there's so many things that like I just where they take Ripley here and the way that it ends, like that her journey ends, no clue. Resonates far more in the other cut because here there is a big fuck you and a very crucial emotional moment near the end that I fucking hate so much.
I got no clue.
And I love that it just doesn't exist.
Like I've seen it maybe once. Maybe perhaps twice. Like I know for sure I saw it in high school, like when I was becoming, you know, more in touch with my cinephile self, and I was like, you know, I gotta rewatch these Alien movies. I really like David Fincher. Let me give this one another chance. I know no one likes it, and I didn't like it then, and I doubt I'd like it now. And to be completely honest, I'm not the biggest fan of the franchise to begin with. Like, there's great iconic imagery. Like, Ripley is one of the better film heroines in American cinema. It's very important, not for multiple people's careers. Obviously, James Cameron, obviously, David Fincher, and not to mention fucking Ridley Scott. But it's I really think it gets a lot more praise than it should. And so does Predator, for that matter. Not the best horror films, mm-hmm. not the best creature features, but that designs are so iconic. Like Stan Winston Studio did such a good job that you can't forget what they look like. And that's why, you know, they've kind of stood the test of time. You know, I do want to see the Shane Black reboot of Predators. I do want to see this Neil Blomkamp film. And to a lesser extent, the Ridley Scott sequel to a film that shouldn't even exist in the first place.
And you know what? That could very well... This could end up being a debt to cinema. The longer cut of it, uh-huh. specifically. That could very well happen because I do think, like, you know... That's the one cut where I feel like at least the movie has at least some sort of merit in just existing. Even though that cut... It's basically considered a work print. And it's the closest that you get to David Fincher and what is his vision of the film and what he was trying to do. Because, yeah, you know,
when
the theatrical
cut
does actually...
Was it 93?
1992. And it does feel truncated in some places just because I'm so used and I have, like, to seeing the other cut and I have that in my head. When I see certain edits that just kind of jump and, like, just feel like weird shifts, it's like, oh, that does feel like something a studio did. So... I mean, yeah, like, this movie will always, it has a very, very weird place just in the history of cinema in general, because, I mean, it is David Fincher's first film. Mm-hmm. It's worth seeing for that reason alone, but, I mean, because, you know, especially when you get to that longer cut, you can definitely just see, like, not just stylistically, but thematically, how, like, you know, because maybe he just wasn't the right guy to make an Alien movie.
I don't think
because
he was
it
at
makes
all.
Sense that he would
even yeah, still
it,
he wouldn't
it does
be.
Make I mean there's bits where, like, just the way that some scenes are, like, shot and just the topics or, like, whatever a conversation centers around kind of reminded me of, like, yeah, I could totally see how this guy shot Seven 3 years later. Mm-hmm. And just based on what he's interested in, like, it does seem weird, but it feels more consistent in the longer cut, and it feels like, you know, what the movie is trying to do on its own terms, it's easier to take that way, whereas for some very, very crucial just emotional moments in the theatrical cut, it just feels like things happen because the studio wants shock value and, you know, to be reminded, like, oh, hey, it's an Alien movie, you have to have this.
Basically, so, it comes down to this.
Yeah.
When James Cameron comes in on a franchise and does his magic, you don't follow it up with anyone else. You kill the franchise because look at Terminator, look at Alien. It just goes to shit no matter what. Nah, like, imagine if Avatar 6 is directed by someone else.
Well, here's the thing, you know, with Terminator, after Terminator 3, like, that's the thing, everyone's been trying to make Terminator 2 all over, or at least with Terminator 3 they were, and then T4, they decided to do something different. It hasn't been working, but Alien 3, at least they did not try to repeat that, and they went in places that were much more intimate and personal for the character, and when it's working, I freaking love it. When it's flawed, I kind of excuse it just because I do know of the production troubles on that, and it is a failure in like quite a few ways, but it's fascinating how that movie comes together, and when it works really well, like it really is something that is just kind of amazing to me and is quite emotional. And I think when it's all done with the work print cut, it like I think it caps off an actual trilogy just for this one character, and it does it quite beautifully, I feel. So yeah, I think it's worth checking out.
Thanks for listening. We hope it's been a pleasure. If you like this show and you want to hear more of our wonderful voices on a weekly basis, check out Two Cents, a recap of what's happened in film, TV, and tech news.
We're also on Debt to Cinema, where one or both of us crosses a title off our list of shame.
You can find all of our content at dollarreviews.net. Follow us on Twitter, or like us on Facebook at Dollar Reviews.
We're available on iTunes, YouTube, TuneIn, Stitcher, and constantly looking to expand to other platforms.
If you listen somewhere we're currently not available, you'd like to contribute some talking points, send a Debt to Cinema request, or if you just want to laugh at us, you can do so by reaching out to us on social media or send an email to brian@dollarreviews.net.
Or you can email me as well, steve@dollarreviews.net.
You can follow me personally on Twitter, @BrianGillis, that's BRYONGILLIS, and now you know how to spell the email too, and also under the same name on the Love You site Letterboxd, which acts as my film diary, where I rate films that I'm watching, write the occasional review, and even sometimes compile lists.
You can also find me on Twitter @S_MTX, and also follow my film diary @Letterboxd under the same name, where I log everything I watch and sometimes write brief reviews.
That's it for this week. Until next time, keep the change. Till the end of time.